Welcome to this worship service from St. Saviour's Anglican Church, online service to all who are here in the video conference by Zoom and also those who are online watching through Facebook. We are starting this new time of worship, again, sharing together with the whole congregation and having the visit and of Bishop Greg, who is leading us through a series of talks on Romans chapter 8. And today is the last one of this series. So thank you, Bishop, for being with us, Sylvia, and all of you. Hope you enjoy this service. Some of us are here in the more immediate video conference where we can have a talk. So whenever, if you are watching this on Facebook and in the future you want to share with us in Zoom to take part in the talk before and after the service, would be very nice. That's a way in which we relate more closely with each other and we know with whom we are sharing a time of worship and prayer. And we hope this, although it's not going to church, it's still an adoration. It's something we do in spirit and truth. Wherever we are, we come to God. I can't forget the very first moment when this thing started, the quarantine. We asked Peter to give a sermon without knowing. He had to stay at home and we had to record Peter, and he sent a recording and we showed the recording in the church. And that was just before the quarantine in the country, but the church said, no, better you stay at home, to many of us. And Peter had the sermon on the words of John chapter 4 that said, those who will worship in spirit and truth. And he spoke about that. And that's in my mind since that day, because it was a reading and what's the emphasis of Peter's message. We should learn, although we are not going to be in the temple, to worship in spirit and truth. And now that's our reality. We are not just forced to stay in a home, but we are also invited by God to experience that worship is not in one place or another, but in the spirit of God. I invite you to follow with me the words in the screen, which I'll share now with you. As we usually have to start the service. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Grace, mercy, and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ be with you. I invite you all to pray with me. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. And now we follow with a hymn, Thou whose almighty word we sing.
Health to those
O Lord, open our lips, and our mouth shall proclaim your praise. Let us worship the Lord. All praise to his name. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen. Now we'll hear a reading from the psalm, which Henny will read, and later John will read a lesson from the Old Testament.
Your statutes are wonderful. Therefore, I obey them. The unfolding of your words gives light. It gives understanding to the simple. I open my mouth and pant, longing for your commands. Turn to me and have mercy on me, as you always do to those who love your name. Direct my footsteps according to your word. Let no sin rule over me. Redeem me from human oppression, that I may obey your precepts. Make your face shine on your servant, and teach me your decrees. Streams of tears flow from my eyes, for your law is not obeyed.
At Gibeon, the Lord appeared to Solomon during the night in a dream, and God said, "Ask for whatever you want me to give you." Solomon answered, "You have shown great kindness to your servant, my father David, because he was faithful to you and righteous and upright in heart. You have continued to have this great kindness to him and have given him a son to sit on his throne this very day. Now, Lord, my God, you have made your servant king in place of my father David, but I am only a little child and I do not know how to carry out my duties. Your servant is here among the people you have chosen, a great people, too numerous to count or number. So give your servant a discerning heart to govern your people and to distinguish between right and wrong. For who is able to govern this great people of yours?" That's it. This is the word of the Lord.
John, may I ask you to read what's this little bit all? Also,
the Lord was pleased that Solomon had asked for this. So God said to him, "Since you have asked for this and not for long life or wealth for yourself, nor have asked for death of your enemies, but for discernment in administering justice, I will do what you have asked. I will give you a wise and discerning heart so that there will never have been anyone like you, nor there will ever be." This is the word of the Lord.
Amen. Now Christine is going to share us and guide us in a time of prayer.
Dear Father, we thank you for being with us every day. We are grateful for the food we eat and the medicine we have when we need it. Thank you for our friends and family, and also for all the spiritual blessings and support we receive from our church. Lord, today we want to pray for our government leaders and especially for our president. He needs your support to lead because the decisions affect the lives of many people. As you did with Solomon, give him wisdom and anoint him with your Holy Spirit to make him a true servant leader. He also needs a discerning mind to stop the virus and stabilize the economy. join all the government leaders in a spirit of unity. Open their eyes to your perspective of decision making. May your word become the truth and guide for all they do. Make them look to you for the last word. We also ask you to give us a discerning mind to distinguish between right and wrong, and give us a spirit of obedience to our authorities, knowing that our acts may also affect others. Help us to be aware of the harm we can do to the people you love so much. We also remember all those who are ill or lost their jobs, as well as the bereaved. May your peace and comfort be with them. Merciful Father, accept these prayers in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. As our Saviour taught us, we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Let's pray now the collect for this Sunday. And we may pray again now with the microphone on. O God, the protector of all who trust in you, without whom nothing is strong, nothing is holy, increase and multiply upon us your mercy, that with you, as our ruler and guide, we may so pass through things temporal that we lose not the things eternal. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Now we hear a reading from the book of Romans. I'm asking Sylvia if she may read, and then Greg will share with us the message for this Sunday.
This is from Romans chapter 8, beginning at verse 26. In the same way, the Spirit helps us in our weakness. We do not know what we ought to pray for, but the Spirit himself intercedes for us with groans that words cannot express. And he who searches our hearts knows the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for the saints in accordance with God's will. And we know that in all things, God works for the good of those who love him, who have been called according to his purpose. For those God foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the likeness of his Son, that he might be the firstborn among many brothers. And those he predestined, he also called. Those he called, he also justified. Those he justified, he also glorified. What then shall we say in response to this? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us, how will he not also, along with him, graciously give us all things? Who will bring any charge against those whom God has chosen? It is God who justifies. Who is he that condemns? Christ Jesus, who died, more than that, who was raised to life, is at the right hand of God and is also interceding for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall trouble or hardship or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? As it is written, for your sake we face death all day long. We are considered as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I'm convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus, our Lord. This is the word of the Lord.
Let's pray. I invite you just to share a moment of prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you that even in these unusual ways that most of us are learning for the first time, we are united in your Son, Jesus Christ. We are in your presence, and you can hear us. Help us to hear you. We ask now that your Holy Spirit will work in our minds and our hearts, that as we hear what you're saying in your word, we might believe, trust, and live with that wonderful hope that your word asks us and invites us to have. We ask it in the name of your Son, our Lord and Saviour, Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Well, once again, it is a joy for Saviour and myself to spend time with you. And we are looking, as Hernan reminded us, for the third time at Paul's letter to the Romans, the 8th chapter. And as we have mentioned before, Paul wrote to the church, to the Christians in Rome, round about the middle of the first century. He'd completed his third missionary journey. He was on his way to Jerusalem. He was at that moment, we believe, in Corinth. He hadn't founded the church in Rome. And he wrote this letter to make sure, in the first place, that they had understood the real basis of the Christian faith. He begins in the early verses talking about the gospel of God, because we need to remember that the gospel is of God. None of what we read in the Bible about our salvation is something that we have thought of. If we think about it, it's because God has spoken. God has revealed what he thinks, what his will is, and what he has done. That's why we come to God's word first, believing. Now, sometimes people say, well, I can't believe without understanding. That isn't true. We trust a lot of things that we don't understand. The whole point about Christianity is, first of all, you believe it. You might understand some of it, but the key thing is you believe it. What does that mean? You trust what God has said and done. You trust it. And then you go on reading, listening, sharing, in the hope that you will begin to understand a bit more what you have believed. Now, I can't emphasize that enough. St. Anselm of Canterbury once said, we believe to understand, and not the other way around. So can I encourage you, first of all, to trust God and what he has said, and then to do your best to understand it. What happens when we understand it? Well, this is why we're studying the 8th chapter of Paul's letter to the Romans, because it's the chapter which tells us of all that God has done so that we can have, and this is the word that we need to understand for chapter 8, assurance. We need to have assurance, because we can be Christians and yet live in a state of anxiety. We can be Christians and live in a state of insecurity. We can be Christians and live in a state of fear. And God says constantly to his people, that expression which, as we said before, occurs 366 times at least in the Bible. That's once for every day, including leap year. Fear not. Don't be afraid. How can we say, well, how can I not fear? Because God has taken steps to keep you safe. So I encourage you to go on reading not just the 8th chapter of Romans, but to read the whole book of Romans. A friend of mine, when he began his ministry in a new church many years ago, said, well, we're going to study together the book of Romans. And he started preaching the first chapter. After 2 or 3 weeks, an old lady came up to him and said, Vicar, you do realize, don't you, we're not used to this kind of sermon. He said, well, what do you mean? And she said, you're talking to us as if we're sinners. Well, that's what the book of Romans is all about, to help us to understand, yes, we are sinners. And that's why God's will is our salvation, because he knows we've disobeyed him. willfully, deliberately, knowingly. And that's a terrible thing. But God's love is so great that he has brought about our salvation. That's the purpose of Paul writing to the Romans. And the early chapters tell us that God has done everything necessary so that we can be not just forgiven, but justified. And I've said before, I'm sure that word is useful in the English language because we can say it's just as if I'd never sinned. Not because suddenly I am not a sinner, but that God treats me as if I had never sinned. That is grace because what has been done. Now you say, but I don't deserve that. And God says, no, you don't. But I've still done it. You don't deserve it. What's more, you can never earn it. Justification by faith was the message of the Reformation. When many people said, we want to get back to what the Word of God tells us. The Word of God had been translated in those times into local languages, and the printing brought about the fact that they could have it in their hands. And they began to say, well, why don't I hear this when I go to church? Why do I hear things that aren't in the Bible? The Reformation. And the key expression, justification by faith. What does that mean? God has made us right with him, and we believe it. So please believe what God has done. Now we come quickly to these last words in this chapter. And what does he tell us that the Holy Spirit does in us? Because this is what God is doing. First of all, he says, the Spirit helps us in our weakness. It's no longer me trying to do my best in my strength. Greater is him who is in us than he who is in the world. We have the Holy Spirit living in us. He helps us in our weakness. When we want to pray, sometimes we don't know what to pray, but the Holy Spirit prays in us. And then he says, verse 28, in all these things, God works for the good of those who love him, who've been called according to his purpose. Everything that happens to you, if you're in Christ, God uses for good. Romans 8, 28. For those who are in Christ, everything works for good. In other words, you might say, I don't know why this is happening. I'm finding it very difficult. Believe me, God is working for good. When Joseph, in Genesis chapter 50, confronted his brothers who tried to kill him, he said, you meant it for evil, but God meant it for good. So believe that all your circumstances are for your good. When our darling daughter, Nikki, was run over and left in an unconscious state in the street a couple of years ago, I spoke to her on the phone several days afterwards and I read her that verse. Terrible. I was not in any way happy about what had happened to my darling little girl, who's now 45 with four children of her own. But I could say, all things work for good for those who love God and are called according to his purposes. And then he asks a series of questions, and they're rhetorical. The question has an answer which is obvious. There are six of them. Look at them later and check them out. First of all, he says, if God is for us, who can be against us? If God is on your side, who can be against you? The answer, no one. Whoever sets against you is defeated from the very beginning. If God is for you, who can be against you? He who didn't spare his own son but gave him up for us all, how will he not also, along with him, graciously give us all things? He gave his son for you. He will give you everything you need. I've got three children and I still have to help them out financially and in other ways, but I don't mind. I would give them anything to help them. And God will give you whatever you need. Please believe what the Word of God says. You can trust him. Who will bring any charge against those whom God has chosen? Who can come and condemn you? Nobody. It's he who justifies. Who is he that condemns? And then the question with which we conclude. And I once again say, read it before you go to sleep tonight, and read it and make it your own. Sign your name under it and say, I receive this. I believe this. Listen to the last words. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? You see, it's not how much you love God in this case. It's how much he loves you. And if you are loved, whatever you do, you will still go on being loved. Can I say that again? If you are loved, whatever you do, you will never not be loved. And once you are loved, nothing can separate you from that love. This is not about me, what I do, what I think, my efforts, what I even try to believe. This is about who God is and what he's done. Now, I was brought up by an English lady. She was English. I never once in all my childhood, up until the time when I met and married Sylvia, was kissed. I was never cuddled. I didn't even know that I needed to be quite honest. I was never called my little darling, my little prince, my little king, all these expressions that we use all the time in this part of the world. But once when I was getting on, I wasn't as young as I was when I was small. I guess I can't remember the age I was, but I was with my mother and she said, Gregory, that was what she called me. I was called Gregory until 1969, when somebody who's not very far from me called me Greg. And since then, por órdenes superiores, I am Greg. Okay, that's just a little bit of personal history. But up until that time, I was Gregory. And she said, Gregory, you are loved. I know I'm loved. And I didn't need any more. I knew I was loved before, but she said it. Listen. You are loved. And nothing and no one, no circumstances, nothing anybody does can separate you from the love of God, because it is the love of God for you. You are loved. Now, you will say, especially if you come from a background like mine, well, I don't feel I'm very lovable. Trust me, you might not be. But you are loved. And that is the end of it. This book is all about the fact that God loves you, but you now need to understand that you're loved and act and behave knowing that you are loved. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for the clarity of your word. We thank you that you leave us in no doubt that you have done everything that could ever be necessary for us to be completely, fully, and totally put right with you and justified. And we thank you too that your spirit lives in us. We thank you that you help us in our weakness. We thank you that all things work together for good because we have been called, and as a result, we love you. And we thank you that nothing can separate us from your love. Help us to believe it. Help us to understand it a little more, and help us to live knowing that nothing can ever separate us from your love. In the name of Jesus, amen. You are loved. God bless you.
We will ask Peter to read the creed, and as he opens the microphone, that's what just needed. You need to open your microphone, please.
Let's say together the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
And now, probably we should have said, I believe, or we believe, we are loved, after the sermon which Greg spoke just now. After what we heard from the Bible, nothing can separate us from the love of God. So we should add this to the creed. We believe we are loved. We are loved. But we also believe we have sinned and we have made not lived according to the love of God. So we confess our sins to God, those we have done against God and against our neighbors, together with this prayer. We say and pray, Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our fellow men in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault. We are truly sorry and repent of all our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past and grant that we may serve you in newness of life to the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy on us, pardon and deliver us from all our sins. Confirm and strengthen us in all goodness, and keep us in life eternal, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
And now we will come to another hymn that's called, Oh, the Deep, Deep Love of Jesus. I'm not sure we have sung this in the church, at least not me. If you have not known this hymn before, please read carefully the lines, the message of this hymn. It is so nice, so great to sing this, to come from what we now believe that we are loved, to worship and say thank you, Lord, for the deep love you have for us.
Oh,
I'll ask our bishop to give his last words, our the blessing for us as we are ending this service.
Thank you, Anand. And before I give the blessing, let me, on behalf of all of us and many others, say thank you to you, Anand, for your hard work in making this service and lots of other things like that possible. We are very grateful. Thank you. And please say great thank you to Lucy for all that she does as well, not just behind the scenes, but say thank you to her and give our love to your dear children as well, please. Thank you, Anand. That comes from me and everybody who's watching and everyone else too. Thank you very much. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you that even in these unusual, difficult, painful and anxious moments, you are our Father. And so we simply say we trust you. And we thank you that even though we don't understand many things, we know you love us and that all things work together for good for those who you have called. And we thank you for enabling us to hear that wonderful calling of us to receive your love, your forgiveness, and to put us right with you and to give us a new life. We pray now as we conclude this moment together for your mercy on this world. Have mercy, dear Father. We pray for your hand on those who make difficult decisions, the government in this country and other governments throughout the world. We thank you for your protection on the world and on your church. And we pray that as we live through these difficult, anxious moments, we might reflect to those around us that there is not just hope, there is love and a future for all of us. So we commit ourselves to you. Be with us. Be with especially those who are ill at the moment. Give them healing and renewed strength. And be with their loved ones too as they go through this time with them. In particular, we think of Dolores and Marcelo. And now may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and your minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you and all those you love now and always. Amen. God bless you.
Just before we say bye to all, we want to give you thanks for sharing with us the service. And reminding you that whoever wants to give an offertory, as we usually do at church, the only way we have now is through the online banking transferences. So the others would say, well, you keep your offertory, and when we meet again, you may bring to the church your offertory. The offerings are a way in which we give thanks to God for what we have received, and we offer it for the extension of his kingdom in both one way to share the gospel through the mission of the church, and also to serve the other ways to serve those in need. This week, we are some people are helping in different ways in the church, giving to those who are in need without a work, without food. Some are cooking food for people who are living in the streets. So we are starting with some actions. Others has been done before. So if you are wanting to help those who are doing this, this is a way through your offering at the church. And also we are, one way we do our mission is praying for those who are in need and those who are sick. So the daily prayer guides you receive through WhatsApp of the church, we keep on praying together at 7, if possible, in the afternoon, every day. And finally, I want to invite you to the last talk of ¿Qué es la Iglesia Anglicana?, which Greg is going to share on Friday at half past 6 through Facebook Live, or also there's the possibility to get in the meeting via Zoom, and there you can bring your questions for the meeting. So that's all we have at least to share now. There are many other things, but these are the main messages, activities in the church during these days. Finally, we should say, go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ, Amen.